Okay, welcome everyone at this webinar of the ISCB Student Council. Today we have a great speaker and great talk, Sebastián Ayala from Universidad San Francisco in Quito, Ecuador. So he's going to tell us about in silico detection of horizontal gene transfer in Streptomyces flavulligerus, sorry. So before to start, I want to remind you that you can follow ISCB Student Council on Twitter at ISCBSC. Also, please stay tuned in our channels for next calls to submit an abstract and to be part of this initiative. So thank you very much, Sebastián, and please go ahead with your nice talk. Thank you.
Okay, hello everyone. Thanks to the ISCB Student Council for the opportunity to share my research project. So I am a biotechnology undergrad student at Universidad San Francisco de Quito in Ecuador, and I am going to talk to you about a project called In Silico Detection of Horizontal Gene Transfer in Streptomyces flavulligerus. So I contribute to this project during a summer internship. I participated 2 years ago at Grupo de Bioquímica Informática, which belongs to the Universidad de las Américas at Quito, Ecuador. These are the research areas of this group, and the research I will explain fits in the third research area, evolutionary and comparative genomics. So this is the presentation outline, which is divided into an introduction to the research topic, methods we applied, results we obtained, and conclusions. So, I think all of us recognize this sketch, which appears in one of the Darwin's notebooks wrote in 1837. Later, in his famous book, On the Origin of Species, Darwin wrote his quote, "The affinities of all of the beings of the same class have sometimes been represented by a great tree. I believe this symbol largely speaks the truth." And as we know, this truth was that all the living organisms descend from a common ancestor and evolved by natural selection and other mechanisms. So, using this metaphor, the life history is represented as this big tree, originated from one single trunk that bifurcates into branches that in turn split into twigs, where from the leaves grow. So, the leaves represent the species. The twigs are analogous to the genera, the branches to the phyla, and the trunk symbolizes the last and single universal common ancestor. So this representation has contributed to our understanding of the evolutionary process, but incoming data on massive horizontal gene transfer events within and across life three domains are showing inconsistencies with the tree of life metaphor. So horizontal gene transfer, or AGT, refers to various processes by which biological individuals can acquire genes coming from outside the germline. This mechanism has been recognized as a driving evolutionary force and allow a gene flow between distant evolutionary taxa. It also provides a new combination of sequences that generally confer selective advantages on the host and can survive in the new genome for a long period of time. So this figure shows some examples of functional horizontal gene transfer events in eukaryotes. So there are many types of these events indicated by different colored circles, and these are distributed, as we can see, in various eukaryote taxa. So, for example, some AGT events are related to degradation of plant carbohydrates with a brown circle. And we can see that this AGT event is present in fungi, metazoa, ciliopora, amicetes, and there are AGT events of other types distributed across the majority of eukaryotes. So inclusion of the AGT events in a life history scan without inconsistencies requires a new representation, which has been suggested as a kind of network, as we can see in figure A. Instead of the tree of the figure B. So the branching coral of life metaphor has been proposed, which allows representing the AGT event through coral branches fusion process, called anastomosis. In this manner, evolutionary lineages can cross, melt, and dissolve into one another over the life history, allowing interconnecting evolutionary lines within and across life three domains. So this figure shows the prototype of the coral of life published the last year by Janos Podany, which has detailed information about this interesting proposition. So in our project, we studied Streptomyces clavuligerus, a gram-positive bacterium that is a high producer of secondary metabolites with industrial applications. As we can see in this table, this bacteria can produce a lot of antibiotics. And also, this bacteria can produce antimicrobial peptides, or AMPs, which are small molecules that protect a host against bacterial, yeast, fungal, and viral infection. It is known that this bacteria contains three short plasmids and a linear megaplasmid that could provide a vehicle for genetic interchange by horizontal gene transfer. So the aim of this research was finding AGT events in Streptomyces clavuligerus. So with respect to the methods we applied in this research, first we obtained the AGT candidates through BLASP searches of the S. clavuligerus proteome against the UniProt database. Next, we retrieved the taxonomy of each BLAST hit using custom Python scripts and MySQL database, and the S. clavuligerus proteins with at least 80% of BLAST hits with a taxonomy classification different to bacteria were selected as AGT candidates. So we performed a global alignment with the BLAST hit candidates obtained in the previous step using MAPT7 and reconstruct a phylogenetic tree using PhyML3. And we manually analyze the tree topology to establish an AGT pattern in the candidate trees. So to avoid obtaining AGT candidates due to contamination in the S. clavuligerus genome project, we verified these sequences in different sequencing projects. Also, we searched for similar proteins to our AGT candidates in other bacteria through BLASP searches against the PATRIC database, and the expression of AGT candidates was analyzed using RNA-seq data available in the GEO database. And finally, the annotation of the AGT candidates as AMPs was done using different predictors, including CAM3, AMPAC, LASMP, NTDP, MRAMP, AMP scanner, and EDP3. And we use servers with the highest sensibility and specificity to predict our candidates as AMPs. The sensibility and specificity was calculated considering a list of verified AMPs as positive controls and housekeeping genes as negative controls. Also, we predict the signal peptide with signal P4.1 web server, and PROSPER was used to predict the post-translational modifications for our candidates to generate peptides from proteins, and to explore the machinery for this modification in this bacteria, we performed BLASP searches against the MERV database. So one of our AGT candidates was an hypothetical protein highly similar to AMPs of arthropods, particularly from the Hymenoptera order and mostly from the Apocryta suborder, as we can see in this tree. We found this protein only in the S. clavuligerus strain ATCC 270-64, and no other homologue sequences were detected in other S. clavuligerus strains or bacterial species, which was verified through BLASP searches against proteins from PATRIC database. Also, we searched for parallax sequences in the bacteria proteome, and we identified one. As we can see, these are the two parallax in the bacteria proteome. Also, both proteins are located in the megaplasmid of this bacteria, and the similarity between these two parallax suggests a recent duplication event. So the presence of these proteins in three independent sequencing projects of the same strain demonstrates that those sequences are not artifacts or a contamination issue. The lack of homologs to these proteins in bacteria and their similarity to Hymenoptera ants strongly suggest AGT has the origin of these molecules in S. clavulacaris genome. So in this figure, we can see the phylogenetic relationship of the AGT candidates shown in red and the Hymenoptera blast hits in black. As I mentioned, the prolog sequences from bacteria are between Hymenoptera ants sequences. The topology observed in the tree strongly suggests the direction of the transference from Hymenoptera to S. clavulacaris, because the majority of sequences are from Hymenoptera and only two from the bacteria. Also, it's important to mention that there are evidence of ecological interaction between the Stratomyces species and Hymenoptera, which led us to think that a close symbiotic relationship between S. clavulacaris and Hymenoptera could lead the transference of these genes. So in the next step, we mapped RNA-seq data from the bacterial strain mentioned before, obtained from the GEO database, to the genomic scaffold corresponding to the AMP-like protein located on the megaplasmid of the bacteria, as I mentioned before. It's proper to mention that this region is the same in the tree sequencing project and encodes one of the two copies of the Hymenoptera AMP-like proteins. So in the upper panel of this figure, it's shown a graphical representation of the RNA-seq data coverage, and in the lower panel, the relative position of the mapping readings to the scaffold region. So considering this data, we observe a clear expression signal along this region. Also, using RNA-seq data from other strain of S. clavulacaris, we didn't map readings in the same region. This result is congruent with the absence of AMP-like protein or tolocs in bacteria, including other S. clavulacaris strains. So the RNA-seq data demonstrate that the codifying gene of AMP-like protein is expressed under in vitro culture conditions only in the strain ATCC 270-64. So to explore whether the AGT candidates maintain the same annotation of the Hymenoptera blast hits, we used seven M prediction software platforms. First, we established the sensibility and specificity of each predictor because we observed heterogeneity in the results obtained from the preliminary analysis. So considering the sensibility and specificity results calculated in base of a list of verified M's as positive controls and housekeeping genes as negative controls, the selected predictors are marked in red in this table, as we can see. So we submit the candidate sequences to these predictors, and we obtain that AMPA and MLAM predictors predict the region from 126 to 137 of the AGT candidates as an M. The ADP3 predicted all the sequence as AMP as an M, and the M scanner didn't predict the AGT candidates as M. So the prediction of our candidates using three of the four most sensitive and sensible programs evaluating this study makes us confident of the veracity of this annotation as an M. So given the predictions of AMPA and MLAM predictors, we followed the possibility that our candidates need post-translational processing from a mature protein in order to be functional. So we perform the prediction of the cleavage sites of our candidate proteins using the web server Prosper. And we found predicted protein sites specifically by serine proteases and near to the end prediction of the programs. Also, we verified the presence of genes coding these enzymes in the S. clavulacaris genome and found this bacteria possesses the machinery to cleave the M-like proteins. So in this figure, it represented the proposed scenario for processing the M-like proteins in this bacteria. First, the prepeptide is produced by bacterial ribosome, and the signal peptide, shown in red, will be used to translocate the sequence to some transporter, as we can see. And the serine proteases will clip the predicted M, shown in blue, and the peptides will be secreted outside the cell. This is the proposed scenario in base of our predictions. So, considering our results, we conclude that an AGP event was found in Streptomyces clavulgaris, specifically between organisms of Hymenoptera order and ATCC 270-64 strain. And it was proved that the transport region is not an artifact. It is expressed because of the evidence I shown before. Also the acquisition of the putative M with possible ecological role and adaptive advantage for bacteria, it was demonstrated. We proposed the possible applications of the M found at clinical and industrial level. So the next step of this research is the laboratory validation of our in silico prediction. To do this, we have some preliminary ideas, including the isolation of S. clavulgaris megaplasmid. As I mentioned, these sequences, the M-like proteins are located on megaplasmid. So the idea is isolate this megaplasmid and the transformation of E. coli with the plasmid and the M production verification in this bacteria. So these ideas haven't been developed, but we hope to do it soon. And finally, I want to thank to Daniela Santander Gordon, a group of the Bioquimioinformatica members, especially to Vinicio Armijos, who gave me the opportunity to collaborate in this project and provide me proper guidance throughout all the stages of the project. Also, thanks to the ISCB Student Council for creating spaces to share our work in bioinformatics. And here are the references. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask whatever you want.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian. So we have time for questions. So Sebastian, I have a question. I watched that you perform a kind of benchmark comparisons across different kind of strategies to infer horizontal gene transfer. Can you please tell me what is the main thing that you developed in your method? I mean, in terms of the difference across the other applications, what is the contribution of your developed?
In terms of the methodology,
yeah.
I think that we performed all the pipeline. For example, in the first step, we in order to associate the taxonomic information of the bacteria, we download the UniProt database and we perform a MySQL database, and we use Python scripts to associate the taxonomic information of the blast hits because. We perform blast searches against all the UniProt database in order to found AGT events in this bacteria. So, for example, this was one contribution of our work, and also our pipeline was based on previous research of horizontal gene transfer detection from eukaryotes to prokaryotes, or between domains of life, I think. So I think that that was our contribution. And in general terms, to predict AGT events, there are two approaches. One is the phylogenetic analysis, as we develop in this research, and the other is the feature genomics. Feature genomics as GC content of the organisms. But we try to apply this approach of genomic features in this research, but we didn't find this useful because probably the AGT event we found was old, and the genomic features of both species is indistinguishable, can't distinguish between the two species.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian. So we have a question. Can you please read the question, Sebastian?
Yes. Inkasuro, why you choose a threshold of 80% in the blastocyst search? The threshold of the BLASP, we used the candidates with at least 80% of BLAST hits with taxonomic classification different to bacteria. It's not the threshold of the BLAST, is at least 80% of BLAST hits with taxonomic classification different to bacteria. So we choose this value in base of previous research that report this value as reference to found this type of events. And with respect to the GC content, we check the GC content, the difference of GC content between the bacteria sequences and the hymenoptera sequences, and we didn't find differences. Probably because the process of amelioration, the amelioration process is the process by which the foreign sequences evolve to imitate the genomic features of the host sequences. So we didn't find difference, and probably it's because the amelioration process. And with respect to the method for generation of phylogenetic tree, we use PhyML tree, and we evaluate other algorithms. But we verified that PhyML tree was the best algorithm for the tree reconstruction.
What do you think if you try another phylogenetic methods in terms, for example, Bayesian method? Do you think that maybe you are going to have different results, maybe? Or
I think that could be the most probable scenario. It will be that we obtain the same results. And we in this study the preliminary results we try different methods, and we select finally the PhyML tree. But I think that the results will be similar using Bayesian or other approach to the phylogenetic reconstruction.
Okay, Sebastian, thank you. So I think that's all. We have no more questions. Last question, maybe. Okay. So once again, thank you very much, Sebastian, for this great talk, and see you.
Thank you very much.
And thank you everyone for being here today with us. Bye.
Okay. Thank you all. Bye.